drinking coffee at a coffee plantation. Hello, my name is Alfredo and this is Off the Strip, where I introduce you to places just minutes off the Las Vegas Strip or take you on one of my adventures. If this is your first time to my channel, please hit that subscribe button and that notification bell. More information is listed below. In this video, we are in Gold Coast, Australia. Since our time here got short, we didn't get a chance to experience this wonderful pool at the Marriott in the Gold Coast, but it's a beautiful place. So we won't get to experience swimming in this pool and feeding the fish and all that kind of stuff and all the other water activities that they have at this resort because our time here got cut in half and we're about to leave for Mount Tamborine tour. Coffee tasting, wine tasting, and all that kind of stuff. So we're on our tour to Mount Tamborine. So here's our guy, he's driving us. So we're at the Tamborine Coffee Plantation. We're about to do a tasting of different coffees and also a demonstration on how they grow, dry, process, and all that kind of stuff. It's one of the only coffee plantation in Australia, actually, so pretty excited to see it.
You can see we've got some fresh foliage coming on, so that's just the end of the picking season, which means the new growth has begun. So, as I said, fruits once a year, and coffee essentially is a fruit tree. It's a stone fruit, okay? The word coffee bean just comes from the way it looks. Okay? Essentially, it's a coffee cherry. It's a fruit. This would be a good example of a coffee cherry that's ready to pick. Okay, see how it's that deep cherry red? This is a good example of how it looks as it's come through as a bean, but it's not ready to be picked, obviously. It's still green. And then there's some different stages of ripening happening there. Okay. You'll also notice the fresh growth coming through. Comes through on the nodes of the stem and it's just beginning to burst out with some flowers. So that's how the coffee cherry begins. A lot of different ways you can process coffee to get a different flavor profile at the end. We use a honey process here. When you go to honey process, we leave this slimy mucilage on and that slimy mucilage dries onto the coffee. And it starts to have this sort of honey, light honey color to it. So honey doesn't mean we use honey at all, it's just refers to the color of the coffee. Is everyone going to be tasting the coffee today?
There's a sample.
Quite a white flavor, very different to espresso coffee. Yeah.
So as part of our tour, we're having lunch here at the picnic. It's kind of a charcuterie board with wine, juices, coffees, and whatever we choose to have. But it's supposed to be really cool. It's a nice little spot in this little village up in Tamborine Mountain. So now we're on a hike down to the waterfalls here in Tamborine Mountains. As you can see, it's a forest all around me. There should be some wildlife, but they said they're kind of hard to spot. But up here in Tamborine, there's you know, maybe some koalas, but really not because there's not a lot of eucalyptus. Rare that there are kangaroos because we're up a little too high. But there are some wild ones, but obviously possibly snakes because there are snakes everywhere in Australia, our guide said so. It's a bit of a hike, but it's an easy hike. along the stream. It's actually a really nice, beautiful hike. Actually reminds me of Road to Hana hikes in Maui.
So she builds that little burrow. She'll burrow in about 40 centimeters into the bank, and when she feels, she runs the spider web back to where she basically lives. When she feels something crawling over that door, she'll come out, she'll slam the door open, she'll drag it in, paralyze it,
right,
then suck all the insides out of it and spit the shell out. I used to get people back in here and say, listen to the buzzing. They'd come out. Yeah, but now you can't, because there used to be a beehive up here.
Oh, right.
And now there's not, so.
So now we've come to this small village in Mount Tamborine. We're gonna kind of look around. It's less than a kilometer both ways, but we have an hour here to kind of explore all the shops, wineries, restaurants, chocolatiers, souvenir shops, stuff like that. So we're gonna check it out, see why this fudge place is adults only. Is it laced with marijuana? Is it alcohol? Is it topless? I don't know. Okay, after sampling several pieces of fudge, they are really sweet, but they're really good. I had a chocolate Bailey's, a black coffee, and a lemon meringue fudge. So it's all pretty good. So it's all adult only because it's they make it with alcohol, and they make all the fudge in this little shop here. I reckon the owner that helped us lives in this house, adjacent to her little fudgery. So the Galleria walk, it's kind of, again, in a little village in Mount Tamborine. It's all these little shops and restaurants and a couple of wineries. So it's kind of a really neat stop to just explore. So we're gonna check out this winery, hopefully taste some really good wine. Can't really buy any bottles because, well, I'm doing hand carry only in this travel, and even if I check them in, bottles will be too heavy, but I'm excited to try the wine that's made here in Tamborine Mountain.
Alright, I'll start you guys off with this. So this is our Annie's Bubble Sparkling. This is a favorite for everyone.
Very pretty, honey. It's good. Cheers. So our next one is Moscato. Very tropical. Sweet, yeah. It smells sweet. I haven't even tasted it, but it smells very sweet. It's like a fruit juice.
This one is what we've named the Alchemist. So this is a 60-40 blend of Shiraz Cabernet, so one of our signature wines that we do.
Shiraz Cabernet. It's pretty good, actually. Fruity, dry, good.
It's a little bit more of an Italian style. Serve it chilled. Very fruit-driven, nice, big bold wine.
So this last one is called their Sweetbread. Pretty good. Wow. It doesn't taste the way it smells to me.
Yeah.
It tastes different than it smells. I like it. I actually like this one the best. So our next stop in this tour is the Cauldron Distillery. We're about to sample three different gins that's made in this distillery.
Familiar enough with juniper or not, but I'd say it's a member of the pine family, question mark. It's a very distinct smell.
Yeah.
You're making me
the Cauldron Distillery, where they make gin, handcrafted, artisanal. They make everything here. They bottle it, they label it all by hand. This used to be a winery, as you can see, but it's a failed winery, and then this group bought it out to make a distillery.
So you've all got your paddles in front of you. They've all got little numbers underneath the glasses. So I'm gonna run you through the drinking order. So first one up in your number one spot for the strawberry, that one there is our Sunset Gin. It's our take on pink gin. If you haven't had pink gin before, it's typically a sweeter flavored gin. We get our sweetness from honey, which we source from beehives about 300 meters down the hill that way that we have on site. So all the sweetness comes from that. And all the pink coloring comes from red hibiscus flowers. So all of our gins don't have any artificial preservatives or coloring, so all that coloring comes purely from the flower. In the bottles inside, you will notice it is quite a lot more pink. The moment a little bit of ice gets in there, it does dilute that color down a little bit, but that's also a sign of the freshness as well. Your next one up with the mint in the middle, that one there's our mountain gin. This one's my personal favorite. It's our take on a classic dry gin. You've got 14 botanicals in it, however, so it's quite complex. You've got oranges, lemons, limes, heaps of citrus flavors in there. So it makes a really nice citrus flavored drink. It's also made with a lemon myrtle flower to add onto that flavor, but give it a dry finish as well. So it's a really nice, crisp drink. Your last one on the end with the watermelon. This one here is our coastal gin. So it's our navy strength gin, 57% compared to the other two being 40. A lot of people get daunted thinking it's gonna leave a burning trail of fire down their throat when they drink it. It's actually very smooth. Yeah. So we steep macadamia nuts in the back for about 24 hours, get all the natural oils out from it, throw it in the distiller with the rest of the ingredients like vanilla beans, salt bush, pink peppercorn. Essentially gives it a bold, savory flavor. Steers away from those fruity, sweet kind of flavors of gin you typically see and goes down more of that savory path. So if you like whiskey and that smooth kind of mouthfeel it has, you'll quite enjoy the last one there.
This is the pink gin with strawberries.
As they say in India, give it Indians.
So after we did our tasting, they did something special for us. They gave us their limited edition Christmas gin. To be honest, it smells like fruitcake. It smells really good, very fragrant. Nutmeg, cinnamon. I don't know, he listed a bunch of other stuff. There's an orange in there, and then they aged it in a Moscato barrel. So it's kind of got sweet. It really does smell like Christmas. That's really good. So the Christmas gin is so smooth, no burn at all. I would like to drink this all, but they only gave us this little bit. So I'm kind of savoring it, but I'd like to really chug it, but I'm just saving it because it's so good. So good news, they had a little bottle of the Christmas gin.